you for joining us today. We trust that you will be motivated, challenged, and inspired by this week's message. Let's join Mike now.
We need to respect God's no, despite how desperate we are for his yes. One of the most important points I could share or make today is stop beating the donkey, because the devil's not always diverting it, but God's sometimes directing it. So often in life, we can misinterpret God's intervention. Equally, there are times when what we perceive is bad situations, we actually discover God is behind working for good. Remember, God is working all things together for good. They won't always look good. They won't always feel good. We live in a feel-good society, don't we? Feel good. Destination's always good, but the journey is sometimes challenging. I'm going to say something even more controversial. Hold on to your neighbor's leg. But please hear me out, because I'm going to explain what I mean. So don't take the first statement and go, all right, here we go. The devil is not always behind every breakdown, and God's not always behind every breakthrough. I'm leaving some silence for it to penetrate the heart. Sometimes, let me explain myself. Sometimes the devil is leading us into a breakthrough in order to break us down. So he'll make it look like it's a breakthrough, but the other side of that is not good. Whereas God is sometimes leading us through a breakdown because it's leading to a breakthrough. Do you see how we can't just simplify everything to good and bad, God and the devil? We have to understand that God works in our bad for good, and the devil works in the good for bad. That's why we got to be ultra discerning. See, I wonder how much of what we perceive is God's perfect will for us is just our wishful thinking. I've heard a lot over the years. Well, God told me, and God showed me, and God said to me, I'm not going to be the judge of that. I can't be the judge of that. I can help you understand how God speaks, and I can help you understand how God moves. But even I'm on a journey trying to understand sometimes the way that God speaks. But one thing I do know is when we want to make something happen, we become very gifted at saying things that we need to say to convince others that God is in it. Oh, Pastor, you're preaching something that's resonating with me right now. You don't want to admit it, but it is true, isn't it? That sometimes it's just wishful thinking. But I so want. When you want something that much, you justify it. Ever justified your finances to afford something you so desperately want? Are there some people that are going to help Pastor Mike today who's got his hand up going, I've done it. Oh, yeah, I think I can afford that. Yeah. Oh, I definitely can afford that. Well, if I do this, yeah, Larry, no, I can do it. Sometimes we can make things happen because if we kick the donkey hard enough, it will move. And if we badger God long enough, he might just relent and agree to what we're asking, knowing that sometimes we have to learn the hard way, just like Balaam did, who he was desperately trying to stop. He's going, Balaam, this isn't the right way. This isn't good. There's some things in you that have got to change. See, God knows the consequences that will come from our decisions, and he really, honestly, loves us so much, he doesn't want us to go through those consequences in life. He really does want the best for us. But in order for that to happen, he has to get the worst out of us. Let me tell you today, God loves you. He's absolutely in love with you. And that's why he wants the best for you. And that's why he wants good things for you. But he wants you to be discerning, to understand that sometimes there are things that we can't see that we need to see. And the enemy sometimes works disguised as one of his angels to lead you astray. So all these things God was working through because, and I love the way the message puts it, Balaam was getting way ahead of himself. Getting ahead of God's plans is something that's so easy to do. Doesn't take a lot of effort. But we have to understand timing is crucial. Timing is crucial. And here's the thing. Sometimes God's not saying no way. He's just saying not now. God's not a killjoy. He wants the best for us. He wants us to experience everything that he sent Jesus to die for. The life that he said we would experience in abundance. But there's timing. And sometimes we are just not ready. Oh, we convince ourselves we're ready. We try and get support around us to tell us that we're ready so that we can go back to God and say, well, everybody thinks I'm ready, but you don't think I'm ready. What's wrong with you, God? I'm ready. Look, everybody's confirming it. You know, we can get confirmation from other people if we try hard enough. We just do what I said at the beginning. We just tell half-truths rather than the whole story. Oh, yeah, I think God's leading you. Wouldn't it have been great if someone would have stood up to Balaam and go, you know, there's something in you, Balaam, that's not right. And if you sort that out, God can use you greatly. But while you've still got that, something's going to happen on your journey. The donkey's going to conk out. God's going to cause your donkey to break down. I wonder whether... You know, it just reminds me of so many things that in our life we kick against. What happens when we break down in our car? We want to kick the car. And yet God's trying to show us something through it. What happens when we get held up on the motorway in traffic? And we're close to cursing. Which is probably cursing. If we're close to it. But you know, we're just getting so mad and frustrated. God, come on, I need to get to this appointment. I need to get to this place. And God is saving us from something up ahead that would destroy us, but we can't see it because we've got a blind spot. The blind spot is not trusting God in situations when there have been so many times on the road when we have been held up and it's been so annoying and I've got so frustrated and only to find out that someone's had an accident and I could have been involved in that or I could have been them. I remember one day, it was actually not long ago, we were near Bristol and just before Avonmouth and a car had literally skimmed across the road in the rain and gone through the crash barrier and ended up going over and over. In fact, you couldn't see it. It had gone down in a ditch. I don't know what happened, but there were loads and loads of police and ambulances and fire brigade. And you think that could have been me. And God was showing me, slow down. This water's dangerous on this road today. How many times did God try and get through to us? And he's not trying to make our day more difficult. He's trying to save us. Woo, Pastor. See, sometimes we can't work God out because we don't understand the realm he's working in or the level he's working on. He sees things that are ahead of us. He knows everything about our lives, and he has ways, and his ways are higher than our ways, and his thoughts are higher than our thoughts. So he's way above us, and he's way ahead of us. We just got to trust him. And he will use the most obscure things to speak to us and get through to us. I mean, think about it for a second. I was reading this story and I was like, God, I know there's something more to this. I spent like 2 days reading this, going, show me something I haven't seen that would really help folk on Sunday. Because we know this story, but there's something that you need to show me. And he said, how about this? Balaam has a whole conversation with his donkey. And not once does it dawn on him that his donkey is speaking. And it wasn't Eeyore, it was English. Well, it was probably Hebrew, but in our version, it was English. Not once did he go, hang on, my donkey's talking to me. That should have been enough evidence for him to realize that something unusual happening here. My donkey has never spoken to me ever before. And he's actually having an intelligent conversation. It says, even with his donkey speaking to him, he still didn't see it. It took God to point it out to him to reveal his blind spot. I wonder, that just got me thinking, man, what is God spoken through? And I've still not heard it, and it should have made me just think. I think the problem, you see, is that we get too one-dimensional. That we don't even realize the donkey's talking. We have to make sure we don't become so one-dimensional that we fail to see the other dimensions that God is working in because of all the other levels he's working on, especially when he's directing us and providing for us. God is multi-dimensional. He can work on any dimension he wants at any point he wants in our lives. So if we're looking this way and God's working way up there, we're going to miss it big time. What's the enemy going to do? He's going to come in dressed as an angel of light and work here so we'll be convinced that God is leading us here. But God's saying, hey, I'm over here. Reminded me of the story of a very religious man who was once caught in rising flood waters. And he climbed onto the roof of his house and trusted God to rescue him. A neighbor came along in a canoe and said, the waters will soon be above your house. Hop in and we'll paddle to safety. No thanks, replied the religious man. I've prayed to God and I'm sure he will save me. Short time later, the police came by in a boat. The waters will soon be above your house, sir. Hop in and we'll take you to safety. No thanks, replied the religious man. I've prayed to God and I'm sure he will save me. A little time later, a rescue services helicopter hovered overhead, let down a rope, and the guy shouted, the waters will soon be above your house. Climb the ladder and we'll fly you to safety. No thanks, replied the religious man. I've prayed to God and I'm sure he will save me. All this time, the floodwaters continued to rise until soon they reached above the roof of this guy's house and he drowned. When he arrived at heaven, he demanded an audience with God and ushered into God's throne room. He said, Lord, why am I here in heaven? I prayed for you to save me. I trusted you to save me from that flood. Yes, you did, my child, replied the Lord, and I sent you a canoe, a boat, and a helicopter, but you never got in, you dummy. What more do we want? A canoe, a boat, and a helicopter. One-dimensional thinking. No, God will save me. No, God will protect me. No, God will provide for me. No, God will speak to me. No, God. And all the time God is going, I am speaking to you. I am providing for you. I am directing you. I am guiding you. But you are not looking in the direction that you need to be looking because you're so one-dimensional. And God will not only stop us going in certain directions we can't fathom, but also lead us in certain ways we don't understand. Here's the thing. He doesn't have to justify why he thinks the way he thinks, or why he works the way he works, or why he does things the way he does things. He is God. It's his prerogative. Yeah. We hate that. Come on, if we're honest, we want God to justify. All right, God, I feel absolutely certain I should get this job. And God's not allowing it. And we're pushing and pushing and pushing and we're trying to make it happen. And God's over here going, I got a perfect job for you, but you can't see it because you're so one-dimensional. If you just look over here and let me lead you, it might not look like what you want, but it's everything you need. He just knows best. And we have to enlarge our thinking. We have to enlarge our thinking and accept that he moves in very mysterious ways. Who would have thought speaking through a donkey? The old hymn says, God moves in a mysterious way his wonders to perform. And it reminds us that we won't always understand why God's saying no when we want him to say yes. That we won't always understand why God's shutting the door when we want it to open. We won't always understand why God's leading us one way when we're sure we should be going another. The whole point, which I really want to conclude with, about the whole story here, is about trusting God. Let's not judge our circumstances by what we see, but journey through them by trusting who we know. When we don't understand the direction, we can still trust the director. And when God stops the donkey, don't beat it. What are you beating at in your life right now? It feels like you're hitting your head against a brick wall and you just want to get through that brick wall and God's going, I want you to walk the other way. That's not the wall I want you to walk through. There's going to be some challenges of a wall the other side, but this is not the wall I want you to walk through. This is not the door I want you to go through, but you still keep beating it. I'm going to get this thing down if it kills me. It probably will. See, I think it just comes back to the point that we have to change our perception of godly intervention. Let's start looking for what we haven't previously seen. What haven't we seen before? Because we were looking one-dimensionally. So easy to do it. So easy to do it. Because the reality is, the reason we have to start looking for what we haven't previously seen is because the reality is we can't change what we won't see. We can't change what we won't see. So we got to see it, we got to challenge it, and we got to change it. That's what will happen. If we see it, then we got to challenge it, and then we'll change it. So it's time to recognize our blind spots. What are they? I wonder whether you've discovered any the last couple of weeks. I hope you have. I hope someone has actually had the courage to maybe help you see it so that you can change it and challenge it and change it. Because if we do change them, if we do challenge them, you know what? We're going to find new opportunities come our way and we're going to unleash new possibilities. There's so much ahead of us if we'll just get through and see our blind spots and do something about them. Let's stand. If you're willing to do that, can I lead you in a prayer today? Maybe there's someone here or maybe there's someone online and you've not ever got to know God in a personal way, got to know Jesus in a personal way. So I want to introduce you to him because actually, you know, we won't really successfully deal with our blind spots unless we have God's help and be in a relationship where he can speak to us, where he can show us, where we can discern what he's saying to us. We need to be in that relationship. I want to just say this. How can we discern God if we aren't in a relationship where we can hear him? And you know, hearing God is something that we develop more and more and more. It's not a one-off thing. It's not a one-off activity where we just kind of you know, we just hear God once and that's it, but we continue to develop that relationship. And as we develop it, we hear God clearer and we hear God louder and we hear God more frequently. Because what are we doing? We're building this relationship. We know a little bit more of God's character. We know the way that God speaks. I hear God a whole lot more now than when I first gave my life to him. Why? Because I know some of the ways. Now, that's not to say he's always going to work in those ways, because even though he never changes, what he does do is change the way sometimes he speaks to us, which is why we have to look multidimensionally. But what I'm saying, all of that really to encourage you to give your life to the Lord today so that you can have a personal relationship. And don't worry, just thinking, you know, that there might be people thinking, what does that mean? Am I going to have to go and join a monastery? Am I going to become, you know, a nun, or am I going to be a monk? No. We're in a different time where you can actually be a Christian and not do any of that. That's fine. So it's okay. I want to encourage you to give your life to Jesus today. And if that's you and you want to pray this prayer, or if you're in the house today and that's you, pray these words and say, Lord Jesus, I want a relationship with you today. And I thank you that you have already chosen me. And so now I make the decision to choose you. I give my life to you today. And I know that this will be a great journey ahead where I will have the opportunity to grow in you, to discern your voice, to know your presence in my life. And so today, I want to start this off by saying I'm sorry for what I've done in my past. I'm sorry for the things I've not seen, the blind spots that I still don't get. But I thank you for the work of the cross that forgives me for everything that I've done, will do, or ever will do in my future. And I thank you that there is a great future ahead of me. And there is love that will unfold, that will blow my mind, and grace that will enable me to walk on in life. Knowing that I can't be perfect, but knowing that the one who gives me this grace is perfect, and so I walk in his grace. And so today, I give my life to you in Jesus' name. I want to say, if you prayed that prayer online, would you let us know? Because we want to help you. We want to help you find a church that you can join, because that would be the best thing you could do, to be alongside other believers, join the family of God wherever you live. If you're anywhere near here, we're at Priory School every Sunday in Weston-super-Mare, so come along. Come and join the family. You know, one thing our church is getting known for is the fact that when you come, not only will you get a great welcome, but you will feel part of the family very, very quickly. That's how lovely these people are. I know you can't see them today, but they are lovely people. They don't look bad either. We're not keeping their faces off of there just because they don't look good. They look pretty good too. But you know, their hearts are amazing. So they're waiting for you. They're waiting to welcome you. But if you can't join here because you can't get near here, then we would help you to join another church, find another church family that you can be part of. Maybe today you're going, you know what, I know Jesus. But man, have I discovered a blind spot today? Maybe you've been kicking at something. Maybe you've been beating something. It's just not moving. And you thought it was the devil, and you've cast out every demon that you know to cast out. And God's going, hello, it's me. It's not the devil you're fighting. It's me, because I don't want you to go that way. If that's you, I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand right now, but just to pray these words. Or if anything else in this message has helped you, or anything in this series, if you're watching online, the same for you. If it's really helped you, just pray this prayer and say, Lord, thank you for showing me today what I haven't previously seen. Continue to show me the things that I don't see, that I need to see in my life. I know, Lord, that there are so many things that potentially I'm not seeing, and I want to see them. And not waste my time kicking at things and casting demons out of things that are not actually demon related, but actually that you're trying to speak through. And you are in, because you are trying to show me the way forward for my life. The best way, because you are a great God, a good God. And yes, you do have great plans for our lives. And so today, help me not only to see what I haven't seen, but help me to continue the journey in such a way that I will discern what's ahead of me and do what I need to do to journey that and make progress on that journey ahead, to trust you even when I don't understand it, even when I don't get it, even when I want to argue with you, that I would just surrender and say, do you know what, God, you know best. Lead me, guide me, I'll trust you. In Jesus' name, amen.
We hope you have enjoyed today's message. To download further resources, click on the resources icon. If this message has impacted your life, we would love to hear from you. So don't forget to join us next week for another inspiring message.